Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. Certainly one of the most awful aspects of the current conflict in Israel is the taking of nearly 200 hostages from Israel into Gaza, where their fates are, as I am recording this video, unknown. And may God provide them with safety and ensure their swift return to their families. I was personally brought to a very sharp and emotional realization of just how long Jews have been dealing with the challenge of having our siblings kidnapped by the fact that last Shabbat in my local synagogue, we read a paragraph I had never even looked at before, and it was a prayer for the return of captives, the prayer for Pidyon Shvuyim. I was amazed that it had been printed there, and I had skipped over that page for so many years, and suddenly there it is, and full sweep of Jewish history came crashing down on me. And in that context, I just want to speak about one particular incident of Pidyon Shvuyim, of which there are hundreds, perhaps thousands, but one was especially poignant. I do not mean to suggest by discussing this particular case that I'm suggesting what was done in the 13th century should be done at this time. I leave that very, very difficult question up to the rabbinic decisors and to the military leaders in Israel, who will determine which is the best path to follow to safely bring these children and elderly and men and women back to their loving families speedily and in good health. But let's turn now to the 13th century and look at one particular episode of the redemption of captives that did not turn out well. Specifically, I'm referring to the Maharam of Rottenburg. He was a very important 13th century rabbi. He was born around the year 1215 and he died in the year 1293. He was a member of the Baalei Tosfot, which is a school of Talmudic scholars, and he was extremely prolific. He wrote, for example, the Tosfos on Tractate Yuma in the Talmud, and he recorded almost 1,000 responsa, which are legal decisions that are then used as precedent in Jewish law. His name was Meir ben Baruch of the city of Rottenburg, and he's often referred to as Maharam, which is an abbreviation for Moreno Harav Meir, our teacher, Rabbi Meir. Rottenburg is in south central Germany, near Nuremberg and just north of Munich, although he was born in Worms. He was a great scholar who studied with the Or Zarua, very important Ashkenazic thinker, and later he was a student of Rav Yechiel of Paris. And in fact, he was with Rav Yechiel when the notorious disputation with the apostate Nicholas Donan took place in 1240, and he also personally witnessed the terrible destruction of Talmudic manuscripts as a result of that disputation in 1242. We read in the Ashkenazic rite a kina, a lamentation that he wrote for Tisha B'Av, the national day of Jewish mourning, called Sha'ali Srufa Ba'esh. Later, he moved to Rottenburg and he opened up a yeshiva and he spent 40 years teaching Torah there. And he rose to become the widely regarded Gadol Hador, the great one of the generation. He was of such a stature that although he never actually received a formal, position or recognition of like chief rabbi, he was nevertheless widely regarded as the most prominent rabbi of Europe. And the kind of issues that he was dealing with were like disputes between Jewish communities, no longer individual personal disputes. And he issued all kinds of rulings which were hugely influential. His students include, for example, Rabbi Yaakov ben Asher, a very important writer who composed the Tur that later became the basis of the Shulchan Aruch, the Code of Jewish Law. Now, what's the hostage situation specifically? This refers to a major shift in state power that occurred in the year 1273. Rudolf I of Habsburg became the king of a very large region of what we would call later Germany. And this was at the end of a 20-year period called the Great Interregnum. During the preceding two decades, Jews were generally taxed by their local nobles, and the king had only a very small share within it. The king did not have the level of strength to be able to impose taxation on the Jews during that brief period of time. Rudolf I wanted to change this, and he took the status of the Jews, which was called servi camerae, meaning servants of the chamber, which was basically a legal designation that meant that they were reporting not within the regular feudal structure to, you know, a whole hierarchy of peoples, but that they were protected by the higher nobility. And this was especially valuable to the nobility because the Jews were the only ones who were allowed in the 13th century to lend money on interest. They had the monopoly on banking, and so they were a source of revenue for the crown. And you know, the nobles really jealously guarded that. Rudolf I said, no, it should be not servi camerae, servants of the chamber, but servi camerae regis, the servants of the royal chamber. They should report directly to the king, i.e. me, Rudolf I. And he imposed a very heavy taxation on the Jews on top of what the nobles were requiring, which was really an insupportable burden. And so the Maharam, at age 71, made a very difficult decision, saying, you know, we can't get around this, and so therefore we simply have to leave. This was a period of tremendous wandering for Jews who were frequently denied residence privileges beyond a very brief period of time. And so the idea of picking up and moving elsewhere was not unheard of. However, as they were making their way to the south, he was recognized by an apostate Jew in Lombardy, and he was denounced, he was arrested, and he was sent back to Germany, where Rudolf I imprisoned him and tried to force him to direct the Jews of Germany to submit to this new tax that he was imposing. The Maharam refused. The Maharam refused that on the grounds that this would be insupportable for the community, and so he remained in prison. The Jewish community organized a phenomenal amount of money. They actually raised 23,000 pounds of silver, which I did a quick calculation. That would be worth about $5.5 million today, in order to ransom the Maharam out of jail, but the Maharam refused to allow them to pay it. His argument was that if the Jewish community were to rescue him, it would just encourage further kidnappings. A very, very powerful argument, but unfortunately, without being able to pay that ransom, the Maharam remained in jail for the next 7 years until he finally passed away in the year 1293. Even after his death, Rudolf I held on to the body and did not release it until the year 1307, when a man named Alexander ben Shlomo Wimfen redeemed the body itself of the Maharam, and he later arranged to be buried beside him. Again, I want to reiterate that this decision that the Maharam made to stay in jail rather than place an additional burden on the Jewish community, such an awesome and frightening decision. I'm not meaning to say that in any way this is what Israel should pursue. That's not my area of expertise. I'm just discussing this particular case. But it's my hope that by reviewing the life and experience of the Holy Maharam of Rottenburg, it should be a merit for those who are in captivity today. And may God rescue them and bring them back to their families as soon as possible. Thank you very much for watching.